You're watching Fox Sports, home to Major League Baseball, the National Football League, NASCAR, and the new home of the BCS. This is America's number one sports network.
Welcome to Talladega, a track famous for speed and danger. Tony Stewart and Kevin Harvick among those who will be racing today at over 190 miles an hour, trying to avoid the big one, the term used to describe Talladega's spectacular multi-car crashes. The field includes colors and cars of memory. Dale Earnhardt would have turned 55 today. His death in 2001 at Daytona still echoes through the sport. And if you look at cars from Dale Earnhardt Incorporated shop, you'll see that the 11 car of Paul Menard, the 8 car of Martin Truex Jr. have the same familiar black color forever associated with Dale Earnhardt. Fox Sports presents Busch Series Racing from Talladega and from the Hollywood Hotel, along with former championship crew chief Jeff Hammond, Chris Myers. Nice to have you join us, where America gathers every weekend to go racing. Well, 10th Busch race of the season. Cup winners have dominated. They've won them all before this, so a lot of Goliaths out there. Any Davids in today's race?
I'm glad you asked. Yeah, David Green, for example, he has got an excellent chance, I think, of doing something with these guys today. We've already seen guys like Jason Leffler a week ago at a place like Phoenix. He ran extremely well. I think he's another one of those guys that can surprise you today. And we got a lot of rookies involved in this race today. As a matter of fact, we've got 6 rookies, so there'll be a lot of guys, I think, that are going to be looking for an opportunity to make a name for themselves.
19-year-old Stephen Light, who starts 8th, has never run on this track, said he's been working on his Xbox, trying to race the Talladega track so he'll be ready for today. Some rain west of here moving in this direction, so we're going to start the race rapidly so we can try and get this Busch race in. Checking the points and part of that domination, Jeff talking about Kevin Harvick in first place by a wide margin, the largest points lead in the Busch Series in 5 years. Harvick has won the last 2 Busch Series races. He starts 10th today. Don't be surprised if once again you see Harvick in victory lane.
That 29 car, it's like he hit the afterburner.
Kevin Harvick climbs out to get that Gibson guitar, a winner.
That's the cocky Harvick.
Kevin Harvick is off to an impressive and record-setting pace. In fact, you look back to the 25 years of the NASCAR Busch Series, no driver has been on a run like he is through the first 9 races. No one has ever amassed a 200-plus point lead. Harvick's at 289. 5 guys in the history of the series has only amassed a triple-digit lead, but 4 of the 5 didn't go on to win the championship. Harvick wants to be the first driver ever to not drive for 1, 2, but 3 teams and still go on to win the Drivers' Championship. Harvick has never scored a top 10 finish here. He says that is the goal here today, just to survive. Nick Berggren.
Martin Truex today will drive the black number 8. He is undefeated in Busch Series competition here at Talladega. 2 starts, 2 wins. He has a great car. This is the same car that Dale Earnhardt Jr. drove at Daytona this year in February. He led more laps than anybody else, didn't win the race, but we know Truex has an incredibly fast car. He will go off in 12th position today.
117 laps, 311 plus miles. The Aaron's 312 under temperatures in the low 70s. Currently cloudy skies. Some rain coming in, and a number of young drivers, first-timers in this race. We also have a number of Cup drivers, 15, as a matter of fact, that you'll see in tomorrow's Cup race on Fox. Let's head down to the track for the command for today's Busch Series race here in Talladega.
Race fans, it is time for those most famous words in motorsports. Please welcome comedian from Blue Collar Comedy Tour and Comedy Central, Ron Tater Salad White.
Gentlemen, start your engines!
engines.
Ron White for Blue Collar Comedy at White Knuckle Racing here at Talladega. Our group upstairs to call you through the race today and tomorrow. Let's join Darrell Waltrip, Larry McReynolds, and Mike Joy, guys.
Thanks, Chris, and hi, everybody. Well, we're hoping for a better race than what we had last year when 20 cars failed to finish this race. 16 of them got wrapped up in the big one, and 30 or more cars had some kind of damage when the checkered flag fell. Darrell, how do you stay out of trouble here? Can you make your own luck?
Already got bad news. You know, they're talking about some weather in the area. You start thinking about halfway and the urgency that goes along with that. That's the last thing you need on this racetrack, is to tell the drivers to drive hard. We're only going to make it halfway. If they can get through the first 10 or so laps without any big major pileups, then we can settle down, maybe get into some single file racing. But up to that, hang on to your hats.
Well, the first Busch race we did here on Fox, we had such a big pileup that only three cars were running on the lead lap, including one driver who was going to pull in the garage after 20 laps and said, hey, this works out pretty good here. And Tim Fito would finish third in a car that wasn't even going to run all day. But Larry, if we get to go the distance, we're oh so close to being able to run this race on maybe just one pit stop?
Well, yeah, unlike the Nextel Cup cars, the Busch cars, they still have the big fuel cell, 22 gallons. This race is 117 laps. I talked to a lot of teams that felt like they could go close to 55 laps on fuel, and we know the safest place is at the front of the pack. So if you can do it on one stop, get to the front, hug the bottom, tell that driver to protect the bottom, you maybe can win this thing.
There's just really nowhere to hide. You can get in trouble at the front, you can get in trouble at the back. As long as you're up there with that lead pack, there's always trouble a-brewing.
All right, let's go trackside to Steve Burns.
Hey, thank you, Mike. Now, if you were to survey the drivers, and we have, to talk about the elements that you need to win this race, talk to Kenny Wallace, talk to Michael Waltrip. Some elements are fundamental here in Sweet Home, Alabama. Number one, you better have a stump puller of a motor, big steam under the hood. You better have a slick body so she cuts through the air. Maybe more importantly than any, DW touched on it, you better have a lot of luck in case things get crazy on the racetrack. And finally, you need to be in position at the end of this race. You've got to have friends to get to the front.
Thanks, Steve. The Lucky Horseshoe concession is going to do a booming business this afternoon and tomorrow. We're ready to race, rushing the start because of impending weather to the west. You're watching NASCAR on Fox.
Hello, I'm Ken Butler, president of Aaron Sales and Lease Ownership, and on behalf of our 1,200 stores across the USA and the Aaron's Lucky Dog and our best product techs, drivers across the USA, we want to welcome all race fans to Talladega Superspeedway, where you're about to watch the running of the Aaron's 312. The 312 stands for the three reasons to get your products at Aaron's. One, you're pre-approved. Number two, guaranteed lowest price, and you can own your products in as little as 12 months. So fans, sit back and let's go racing.
The field has pulled off pit road. Jason Leffler a little late joining them, but now they are formed up behind the two safety cars. Look at the wind, gust to 30 miles an hour, that's pushing that storm system from out of the west toward eastern Alabama.
Well, you run 180 side by side, then you get a 30 mile an hour wind gust. Woo, you might get trouble there.
That's going to be the biggest factor as far as weather's that wind.
Let's have a look at our Prilosec starting grid with J.J. Yeley on the pole, his second pole. They both came in this year's restrictor plate races. Clint Bowyer outside. Yaley's teammate Denny Hamlin right behind him. First of the non-Cup drivers, Denny O'Quinn, will start fourth. Brian Vickers, former series champion, Aaron Fike, Carl Edwards, Stephen Light, that whole outside column, except for the front row, non-Cup drivers, Kyle Busch and Curtis Davis. Johnny Davis's independent team with only three full-timers gets a top 10 start. Great job.
You know, when you look at our top five in points, including our points leader, Kevin Harvick, none of those guys have ever had a top 10 finish even at this racetrack.
Here's Leffler pulling up into his position after being late, leaving the starting grid. Trying to get all his safety gear hooked up, and he's good to go.
Bernie Lamar finished second at Daytona back in February. his first restrictor plate race.
Looks pretty comfortable all laid up in there.
John Wood getting a little fresh air with his hand out the window.
Finished second here 1 year ago.
Looks pretty serious already.
Sinister.
Yes.
The black helmet.
It's that helmet and that shield.
Yeah. He didn't armor all that helmet, you notice. It's flat black.
Who is that masked man?
John Wood.
John Wood. Johnny, be good.
Michael Waltrip. Good thing he's got gloves on, or you'd see he had no fingernails. He's kind of chewing on them, waiting for Cup qualifying to finish up earlier today, but he is in the show for tomorrow.
Surprised he didn't flip that lid up and tell us how many commercials or how many sponsors he got on the car today.
Birthday present for him, though. He'll be 43 years old.
Yeah, I'm happy. I'm tickled for him, man. Big deal.
Kenny Wallace.
Already looks jukey.
Yep.
You know.
Ready to roll. Larry, let's have a look at our FedEx racetracks for today.
There you see it, 117 laps, 311 miles, pit road speed, 55 miles per hour. I talked about the pit window right there, 50 to 55 laps. That could be a very important factor of the outcome of this race. Now the FedEx racetrack keys, pit road efficiency. If indeed you only make one or two pit stops, you want to make sure you're effective and especially no mistakes on pit road by the driver or by the crew. Spotter is your best friend. He is more important to you today as a driver than that crew chief making the calls. And you know what? Imagine this. Avoid the big one, and you'll be just fine. Roll it in the truck, and you can say you've had a good day.
Avoid a disaster or be a part of disaster.
For more information, including DW's hotspots, log on to foxsports.com. Keyword, FedEx. The field was split in two, so two pace cars could help the drivers measure tack reading for pit road speed. Now they're going to form up as one pack. We'll go to Dick Berggren.
In the drivers' meeting this morning, Mike, David Hoots told the drivers be very, very careful to avoid overly aggressive driving. Hoots promised that NASCAR would have people all around the racetrack watching for overly aggressive driving. He urged them to use patience. And why not? Last year in this event, 20 drivers failed to finish. Steve Burns.
Well, Dick, Clint Bowyer is starting second in the number two car. He's also second in points to his teammate Kevin Harvick. Now, Larry Mack talked about how important the spotters are here. And Clint is working with a new spotter the last couple of weeks, Tim Fedewa, a former driver himself who has 333 starts in the NASCAR Busch Series and four wins. So a driver on the roof trying to guide Clint Bowyer to victory here today, Matt Yoakum.
One Busch Series driver with a lot of experience, you might say in a certain way, is Denny Hamlin. Now back in Daytona, he didn't win the NASCAR Busch Series race, but he did win the Budweiser Shootout and a lot of money. So he does have a lot of drafting experience running both Nextel Cup and Busch. Now this chassis is not the same one he had at Daytona. It's one from 2003. They feel like it's a better overall racing chassis, better feel. But one thing his crew chief Dave Rogers told the guys, remember, a lot will happen on pit road, but always be concerned just in case the car stalls. You don't want to lose as much time, Jeff Hammond.
And spotters are on the spot. Crew chiefs, what do you tell Jeff Hammond, your driver here? Yeah, it's easy to say avoid the big one. How does he do it?
Well, how do you do it? But one thing is by being smart. You've got to be willing to give and take, and you've got to basically have eyes 360 degrees in your head, because that's how you stay out of trouble. You start realizing what's going on around you. Things are getting a little bit dicey. You've got to look for an opening or a place to kind of like a safe place to get out of everybody else's way for at least for a little while. Be smart, be patient.
Some of the drivers say the guy who starts it usually is the one who's not involved. It's everybody else who gets caught up in it. Mike?
Mike, I'd like having a former driver be my spotter. I listen to spotters all the time, and they don't tell the drivers things he needs to know. They tell him a lot of things he doesn't need to know. Drivers have instincts. There's things you just don't need to keep telling them.
And there are a lot of former drivers as spotters up on that perch, like Tim Fedewa, who we talked about, finished third in a Busch race here, Curtis Markham. There are others. And, yes, there's definitely a having been there and done that that can be very helpful.
A spotter can actually annoy a driver by telling him a lot of things he doesn't need to hear. Oh, there's a slow car on the inside. Well, I see that slow car.
But, Darrell, I got to believe a word you use a lot that spotter has to do here is anticipate.
Anticipation.
Don't create your own bad luck. You can race three wide. We'll see cars four wide here. That gets a little dicey. And five wide, yes, the track is wide enough, but don't do that.
Well, there's a point where you run out of room. You can get that way, but you got to get back in a couple of lines pretty quickly.
Something unique about the racetrack, the pace car pulls off, but the start-finish line is not in the middle of the front stretch here. It's well on down between the trioval in turn one on that second straightaway coming out of the trioval.
You know why? Because that gives us enough time to do what we do.
Well, exactly right. Well, DWC's the biggest. Like Mike Joyce said, four wide, five wide. You better reach up there and pull those belts tight one more time.
Oh, baby, oh, baby. Boogity, boogity, boogity. Let's go racing at a real high speed, boys.
They still look exactly like how they took the green flag almost a lap ago.
Yeah, and we got to get through these first few laps here with these guys this close together. A lot of young guys up here in the front. We got to make it through these first 10 or 15 laps without any contact.
About a 21 car breakaway at the front. Field pretty much divided in half right now. Double wide, three wide through the first 10, 12 rows.
Yeah, the top 25 cars within a second and a half of each other.
With the package they got on these cars, the plate, the spoiler, and the roof fin, you get such a huge run on the guy in front of you that sometimes you don't have any place to go except right into him.
Yeley led the first lap. Boyer trying up high, but Yaley's teammate, Denny Hamlin, in the 20 locked right onto his bumper.
And just think about Yeley and Hamlin. They're very limited experience on these kind of racetracks, right up there leading the pack around here.
Well, stay low, stay up front. That's the best way to stay out of trouble.
I like staying low.
See, Johnny Sauter in that double zero car caught on the outside. He's waiting for that spotter to say clear low. Right now, he's being shuffled out. Saw Jason Leffler in the 32 car jump to the high side. We're riding with Kyle Busch in the 5 car here.
And his Hendrick teammate, Brian Vickers, just in front of him.
And then see the cars, they just move around. And the driver's not doing that. He's just in there steering it as straight as he possibly can. But 190 mile an hour wind buffing you around, the car's jumping all over the place.
It's Dale Earnhardt Day in Mooresville, North Carolina. And in that grandstand, a lot of fans holding three fingers high, saluting the late 7-time Cup champion.
There you see Martin Truex Jr. in the 8 car making his very first Busch Series start of the year. Two-time champion, 2004-2005. He's won the last two spring races here.
Just got to watch these guys really closely as they get down into turn 3 and down toward turn 1. Again, closing rate really, really big. Sometimes there's just nowhere to go and you make contact with somebody.
26 cars in that lead draft.
Now this crowd back here, the second group, this could very well be by design. These guys could have all gotten together and say, look, let those guys go up to the front, let them race all they want to. Let's stay back here and be safe.
I think you're right. I see a lot of veterans back there, like Kenny Wallace in the 22 car in that group. Tell you what, pretty impressed with that blue car there on the outside. Danny O'Quinn in the 50 car. Remember, he made his very first Busch start back at Daytona in February, qualified up front, running up there like a veteran.
But the danger sign is that yellow bumper, Larry. Talladega, I think even more than Daytona, is one place where the veteran drivers avoid the rookies and working with them. You got to earn that respect. Can't do it in just one or two races. Let's check with Matt.
Mike, Denny Hamlin, third in line in the red and white 20 car. Now, he was telling his team, because I have to tell you guys how great this race car is, and I can't thank you enough. And Curtis Markham, who's a spotter, says, we understand that. Just stay in line with your teammate, the 18, as everything starts to shuffle all around, Mark. Mike.
Boyer on the point. Vickers and Busch tag-teaming in the middle row. And that white car trying to come up the outside.
Clear high.
Busch regular Aaron Fike. You see Tony Stewart, That red 33 right up against Kyle Busch.
And what I'm seeing right there, Tony Stewart, the 33 car driver, 21 car behind him, driver owner. He owns the 33 car, drives the 21 car, Kevin Harvick.
Okay, and all that patience we were talking about, it's over. No more.
But Darrell, I agree with you. If we can make it through the first 15 or 20 laps of this thing, get spread out a little bit, we may be okay.
60 slicing up through the middle. That's Carl Edwards trying to make a third lane down the middle and gain ground.
Bernie Lamar, he was the kind of between the rock between two hard places there, and he had to give a little. That's smart racing right now. Give a little right now, guys. Just be real cautious. I don't like the looks of this.
Lamar backs up in the outside lane, back to about 13th position. Six laps, caution free. Hold your breath.
The Aaron's 312 on Fox is sponsored by Aaron's Sales and Lease Ownership. Nobody beats Aaron's. Nobody. By Allstate, official insurance sponsor of NASCAR. By Yamaha Star Motorcycles. We build it, you make it your own. And by the new side sampler from Pizza Hut. Go for the good stuff. With Jeff Hammond, Chris Myers, the Hollywood Hotel. Tony Stewart, your leader early. Nine laps in, pole sitter J.J. Yeley has dropped back just a bit. It's already been dicey early.
Very dicey early right now, Chris. But that's what we've been expecting all day long. Is some of the veterans like Tony Stewart working his way up toward the front. Guys like Clint Boyer, Denny Hamlin. We've seen some real aggressive racing in the first few laps here.
And Yeley down to ninth. Kyle Busch, who celebrates his birthday Tuesday, up to second. Let's rejoin Daryl, Larry, and Mike.
Moments ago, Kyle Busch made a move for the lead right after Tony Stewart had made a move to the outside. Watch Stewart's red car, the Old Spice car. Goes to the outside, and that hole closes up as Kyle Busch jumped to the outside. Now, did the five car, the blue car there, did he go up to block or go up to pass?
Well, I think he was looking outside of his teammate there, 57, and he saw that he was going to make a move. Here comes Tony with, again, that big closing rate. Got a run there, and he starts around him, and Tony happens to be doing the same thing up on the outside. So that's just good racing right there.
And I think everything's okay. The last thing you want to do is damage one of those front fenders here at this racetrack. It'll end your day for the most part, aero-wise.
Tell you whose car is bad fast. J.J. Yeley drifted back as far as 16th, and he has climbed the ladder back up to 7th. And that number 18.
Oh, you'll do that. With this package, again, you can go all the way to the back of this lead group right here and work your way right back to the front. And one of the things that some of the smarter guys will do, they'll actually try that. They'll get to the back and see how long it takes them to get back to the front. So at the end of the show, they know where they need to be.
And Darrell, the package you're talking about, different from Nextel Cup, is that strip across the roof, which puts more drag in the car, a much bigger rear spoiler with a little fin on it, but it enables these guys to run a little bit bigger carburetor restrictor plate, about 3/64 of an inch bigger than the Nextel Cup car.
Until they went to this aero package, the Busch races were pretty boring on Talladega and Daytona. They just were single file. You can see that this has fixed that problem, created a few others.
Clint Boyer led a lap and then kind of disappeared back to ninth place, doing very much the same thing. He was actually further back. He's climbed to ninth, and now he battles Yeley for what will be eighth. He was drafting along with the one of Mike Wallace as Wallace works forward. Kind of unnoticed in this whole pack, 66 Kenny Schrader running a solid fifth just ahead of Harvick right now.
I think what's interesting, though, is this lead group, just like what we see right now, and then about a half a straightaway behind, we got another big group of guys. So these guys have all kind of gotten together and say, hey, let those guys go and hit. Watch back here coming off turn four now. Here goes the lead crowd. Then here comes another little group that's kind of gotten together and said, here's the race we're going to run.
But Darrell, the problem is they can't continue to lose a half a second a lap. They would need some cautions to catch them back up. We saw a group try this a couple of years ago. We got long green runs. Next thing you know, they were all but getting lapped.
Well, I'm sure they've watched all these races just like you and I have. Pretty sure there'll be a caution.
Yeah. Chances are.
John Wood leads that second pack. This is the first one. Things are still pretty hot and heavy. Is that Johnny Sauter working the high side in double zero with Paul Menard? Menard's teammate Truex in the eight with Clint Boyer. Aaron Fike in that white car right in the middle. Dick?
Still
Stephen Light, the kid driving car number 90, is only 19 years old, making his first start here at Talladega. He qualified in the eighth position, and not long after the green flag dropped, his veteran spotter, Eddie DeHaan, suggested that he just drop back and get a rhythm, get a feel for this place, and as a result, Light has dropped back to the 20th spot.
Darrell DeHaan is a former driver. He raced modifieds in New England and Long Island.
Well, and I love, that's great advice to give your young driver. Hey, get back there, man. Watch this a little while. Work your way back up there. Learn from the veterans.
Yeah, the only experience he has at Daytona Talladega is he ran the ARCA race back in February there.
25-car lead draft, 42 of 43 on the lead lap. Tony Stewart leads Kyle Busch by a whole tenth of a second. Eighteen laps of Talladega, tires starting to wear, cars starting to slide around just a little bit, and still 25 cars up in that lead pack. And how close do they run? We talked about bump drafting. Here's what it looks like. That's Kenny Schrader.
Getting ready to get his yard mode.
Bump. Push from Mike Wallace in the one. And again, so much has been said about bump drafting in Nextel Cup at Daytona back in Speed Weeks. NASCAR made a rule change to the front bumper configuration where they took a lot of the reinforcement. They did not make these changes, these push cars, but this package we keep talking about, that's what started this whole bump draft deal.
The outside line beginning to move. Martin Truex by himself, but he's got a crowd coming led by Reed Sorensen there, and now they form up in a big double file conga line. Let's check with Steve.
Mike, you were talking about the car starting to slide around the racetrack. That's just what Kyle Busch heard from his spotter, Jeff Dickerson. He just told him the 57 in front of you is just a little bit on the loose side, so keeping them apprised of his teammate's situation as well.
And if we stay green, we're not even halfway through this first run. You can go about 55 laps on fuel, as we were talking.
Yeah, if you're a little bit loose now, the next thing you're going to hear is, I'm really loose.
Do the math, Stewart and Biffle, the biggest, and Harvick, the biggest gainers early in this race. In fact, Biffle is in third and going for the lead. He just doesn't have a lot of help on the outside right now, and you see his number 16 drift back. Up comes cousin Carl, his teammate Carl Edwards. Give him a little help.
Yeah, they're starting to assemble an outside line there behind the Biff.
That's what happens, though. You get strung out a little bit, and then somebody will get a run on the outside, and he'll bring a bunch of guys with him. First thing you know, you're back two or three wide again. That's what I like about this package, Steve.
Hey, DW, you see clear. The 16 car there, Greg Biffle from the bumper cam of Kyle Busch. He may have some problems. He's starting to run a little bit hot. He ran into the back. He said he got shoved in the back of the 38 car, and it has damaged the grill of that number 16 driven by Greg Biffle.
And, of course, Steve, we know one of the things that crew chiefs will do to these cars, because it's such a narrow advantage, is run as much tape as you possibly can to help the cars on the straightaways. You damage that nose just a little bit or where the air inlet is, then you're going to start running warm.
Now, he said he got shoved into Jason Leffler. There's no damage on the back of Leffler's car.
No, and I didn't see all that much on the front of the 16. But listen, Larry, this is one of the places where you lean on that engine. You run as much tape as you. If it's 230 and it'll make it go faster, you run it at 230. I don't see any issues with the front of the 16 car myself. It looks pretty clean.
And the good thing now, he's somewhat in clean air. It should cool down where he's running right there.
This is the track where you hear of drivers putting their right foot all the way to the floor and putting their left foot over on top of their right to hold it there.
Yeah, well, actually, that plus you use a lot of brake. You don't want to back off the throttle any more than you have to. You'll drag the brake to slow the car down to stay in the gas.
And what you saw Tony Stewart do right there is he caught Justin Ashburn in that 05 car. He sniffed just a little bit of a draft off that car coming down the front stretch as he was catching him.
Boy, I tell you, that one car, this that one slow car really shakes things up, though. Everybody's moving all over the place.
This looks like the pace lap, but it's at over 180 miles an hour.
You know, not surprised to see that 33 car up there running. Remember, this is the same car with Tony Stewart that won the race at Daytona in February, and it has that Richard Childress power under the hood, and we know how good that power has been good all year long.
Now, that's the car that, if I recall, went off the track going down into turn one.
Well, that was actually last year.
Last year.
Yeah, last year. But he won that race, too, so he's won it 2 years in a row at Daytona.
Let's go to Matt on the leader.
But Larry Mack, think back to Daytona in February. That car, they fought a tight condition most of the race. They were not a major contender. Every pit stop on pit road, they made significant adjustments, changing shocks, changing a lot of different chassis settings, so they finally got that car where Smoke needed it, and then he put it in victory lane for the second straight year. But Wally Rogers told me they made a number of aerodynamic changes so they wouldn't fight that when they came back to here to Talladega, Dick.
Kevin Harvick started in the 19th position, has motored his way forward to the fifth spot, said the car is running well, except the engine is running a bit hot. Vickers has come on his radio also and said that his engine's running a little bit hot, and I just now heard him say it's starting to get tight in the center. That's Vickers.
Greg Biffle led this race for about 300 feet of the backstretch, so he did not get credit for leading a lap. They only count those changes at the start-finish line. Now Biffle's out in front again. Can he stay there?
I think he can, as long as he can keep Carl Edwards tucked up under the back of him, because Carl really pushed him to the lead. Those two cars are working very well together.
See Mark Drex Jr. in the 8 car, sticking the nose out. Carl Edwards in the 60, pulls right in behind Greg Biffle in the 16, his teammate.
Now Edwards wants to lead a lap too, but Biffle has not led one yet officially.
Well, here comes the guy up on the outside though that I think we better keep our eye on, because as you well know, he's won a couple of races here and he's coming to the front with authority.
He's got Reed Sorensen in that 41 car pushing him.
Martin Truex in the black number 8 from Dale Earnhardt Incorporated. Now Biffle did lead that lap. He is the fifth different leader of this race.
Tell you another car that's been right here in this lead pack for the last 10-15 laps. Mike Wallace in that one car driving for James Finch. This is only his second start in this car. He plays Jason Keller. There you see him pushing Jason Leffler. Mike's been doing a lot of bump drafting with this one car. We watched it a while ago on Kenny Schrader. Really gave him a shove down the backstretch.
Five laps complete. Biffle the leader in the Aaron's 312. Martin Truex just a tenth of a second back.
The Aaron's 312 on Fox is sponsored by Smooth Bush Beer and easy drinking Bush Light. Bush, proud sponsor of the NASCAR Busch Series, 25 years running. Carl Edwards running at the front of the pack, just ahead of Greg Biffle here, 29 laps in. We've had 6 leaders and 5 lead changes.
Right now, one of the guys we were kind of pulling for early on, the zero car, Curtis Davis, has been kind of hanging with this lead pack. All of a sudden, he had a little problem down the back straightaway, slowed, actually has a flat right front tire, trying to limp his way into the pits right now, but had a great qualifying run. One of these teams that we've been kind of pulling for all along, because they don't have a lot of money, but they seem to manage to get in these races and try to put up a great effort. But with Carl Edwards, a minute ago, Chris, who got him up there, believe it or not, was Tony Stewart. He pushed him up through there. Now you see Greg Biffle right in behind him running second, but a pretty good push right there by Tony Stewart got Carl Edwards out front.
Yes, a different kind of draft on this day, gentlemen.
Pretty good push there that Tony gave Carl. I mean, you have a run on somebody, and he's got to go. Watch the 60 and the 33 here.
Carl's using the yellow line there on the left to protect the inside.
And Greg Biffle in the 16 was just a sitting duck.
You get out there a little bit too far, the guy behind you will just absolutely drive right by you.
You could almost hear the RPM come up on that car as Stewart was giving him that bump down the back straightaway.
Edwards got a little help from his friend, but not now.
Man, you should have, look at that. They went through turns 1 and 2, 4 wide.
5 wide now.
And the problem is the racetrack's plenty wide, but you talked about it a while ago, these cars bouncing around at 190 miles per hour. Somebody just made the wrong bounce. Next thing you know, we got a bunch of cars tore up.
What caused that was Carl Edwards started to back up and everybody scattered to either side around him.
Yeah, there's just when you're in a situation like that, there's a little bit of unpredictability about what your car is going to do. You've got a hold of it, but sometimes it'll move around unexpectedly.
Tony Stewart, 33, will get credit for leading that lap right there back to the front.
8 car to the corner, 2 wide. Right on top of you. too wide.
There you see Mike Wallace back in that one car up there, the top side at the front of that line, getting the help from Johnny Sauter in the double zero car. They got quite a push. Plus, they're getting a little draft off that zero Curtis Davis car.
Curtis Davis is going to be right in the way, though. He's right up there. He's trying to stay high to give everybody room, but, man, he's going to bottle him up a little bit here. Unfortunately, they're going to catch him in the trioval. That's going to help. But listen, the trioval, think about this, guys. The turns are banked 33 degrees. The trioval is banked 18 degrees. You're loose as a goose coming through that trioval. Man, if somebody bumps you there, you're around.
Yeah, and 18 degrees of banking, that's more banking than like we have when we go to Richmond next week and through the corners.
But, you know, you're running just the same speed as you are in the corner, 190 mile an hour coming through there. That's the toughest part of the racetrack, really, for the car handling.
Three wide, a good way is through this pack. First car in the middle, 41 Reed Sorensen, four wide off into the corner.
Another big deal is when they're four wide is what lane do you get in? Who do you follow?
Starting to see our pole sitter work his way back to the front. J.J. Yeley in that green 18 car working the high side. He falls in front of Johnny Sauter in a double zero.
I think J.J. had to regroup a little bit. It's not going exactly like I thought it would.
Reevaluate.
Yeah.
See Gene Need there in the Dollar General uniform there. That's the crew chief for Bernie Lamar. And Wally Rogers in the Old Spice uniform, crew chief for Tony Stewart, I'm sure as we're 34 laps in this run, they're starting to talk about when do you think about pitting, because this is the one place you want partners to come to pit road to be able to stay in the draft together when you leave pit road, especially under green, obviously.
Well, Lamar is 21st. As you ride along with him, looks like a ways to the front.
But, Mike, let's do them squeeze. That's the other thing about this bigger plate aero packet, squeezing in and out of the throttle. You don't have to hold it wide open all the time.
34 laps complete. Pit stops in the next 15 to 20. Tony Stewart leads Carl Edwards. Tony Stewart out in front of Carl Edwards. Nothing has changed. Still a big tight pack at the front. We have had one lap when the first 10 cars came past the start-finish line, mostly single file.
Now, I know the guys all say, oh, anybody can drive these cars here, and they don't, you know, handling is not an issue. But when you get close to the end of a fuel run, when you get ready to make pit stops, that's when handling is an issue. And it's not so much that you can't keep up, you can't maneuver. You've lost your maneuverability because you've lost a lot of grip.
New leader, Kyle Busch. And he brought Reed Sorensen along for the ride and Mike Wallace. They are the first three on the inside. Clint Bowyer is the first car in the outside lane. And Tony Stewart's been kicked back to about fifth or sixth in the 33.
Got to give that old Mike Wallace an attaboy in that one car. I mean, he's been right there in the front the whole time.
There you see him three wide for a bit. Matt.
Even though Stewart's been kicked back a few positions, Mike, now you saw a number of different crew members from different teams talking to Wally Rogers, trying to figure out when he was going to hit pit road. At this juncture is a 20 car, Denny Hamlin on pit road along with his teammate, the 18, J.J. Yeley. Looks like the right front possibly soft on the 20 car of Hamlin. As he peels off. Now his car was tight. You can see the right front definitely low. They're going to make a chassis adjustment. You can see the crew member crank on the wedge. They've already made an air pressure adjustment. Way too tight for Hamlin. Steve?
Well, Matt, J.J. Yeley, the pole sitter, says his car has been just a little bit snug from the beginning of this race. They're going to make an air pressure adjustment. Obviously, four tires for J.J. Yeley. Their service is finished.
Now, this is just a little bit early for these green flag stops. With stopping here, they will definitely have to make another pit stop to make it to the end.
Yeah, those teammates pitting together, but Hamlin blew that, or didn't blow the tire out, but that tire went down because he locked it up and slid it all the way to pit road. And these tires are so thin that it wore right through.
Yeah, you're trying to get full advantage of through three and four. Coming to pit road, you're going from 185, 190 to 55.
Now, Bernie Lamar, we saw running slow on the apron. He's just completed his pit stop. What happened? Matt?
Mike, he had a flat left rear tire. He was about five or six laps from hitting pit road as well. They had planned on pitting with their corporate teammate across the KHI stable, the 33 of Stewart.
Hey, what, Kevin Harvick there in that 21 car, he just ran up through the middle right there, starting to get a little bit of help from Mike Wallace, which is getting help from Tony Stewart in the 33 car behind him. 3x3 all the way through the trial.
They're all three wide. You call that help?
I call it breathtaking myself.
You bet.
Riding with Kyle Busch, get a little bump draft from Kevin Harvick in the 21.
Four wide, middle of the corner. You don't see it there, but my goodness, that was close.
Of course, Yaley's just off of pit road. He's just trying to hang in there to all these other guys' pit.
Inside 18, 21, big shove right here.
Hear them working the throttle. It's something you won't hear tomorrow, I guarantee you.
Trouble, front straightaway in the tri-oval. Two cars locked together.
That was Derek Cope and Ashton Lewis. That's actually Regan Smith in the 35. Couldn't get by.
Now, scoring stops. Scoring is frozen. So everyone else gets to slow down and pick their way through this three-car pileup in the tri-oval.
Regan Smith in the 35 almost made it by here. You see Derek Cope in the 49 that we saw sideways in the tri-oval right before that.
Yeah, it's a shame. Regan had that thing.
In the door, right rear.
First caution of the day, lap 44. That's Randy McDonald. Or excuse me, Donnie Neuenberger, Cayman Islands car, and here is 49 of Cope. Let's see what happened in this second pack. Watch the green car, right center of your screen.
This is getting to the, oh.
He hooked Regan Smith.
Well, no, Regan hooked him, yeah. It looked like he was going to move up a little bit, and Regan caught the back of him, of Derek Cope, and turned him, and then here comes Derek, and he says, ooh.
Neuenberger in the 72 was just a victim, just nowhere to go.
You know that real time? It looks real bad. Watch this.
Smith's teammate Ashton Lewis will get the free pass. 18. Free pass will go to our pole sitter.
Yeah, he was right. He was hanging with them right there.
Right.
I wasn't even for sure if he wasn't ahead of them when the caution came out, but apparently he was got the free pass, so that's all that matters.
And that'll leave the other two cars that had just made green flag stops. Denny Hamlin in the 20, Bernie Lamar in the 77, still one lap down.
First caution of the day in the Aaron's 312.
The Aaron's 312 on Fox is sponsored by Aaron's Sales and Lease Ownership. Nobody beats Aaron. Nobody, not know-how.
At Talladega, pit stops have begun. Reed Sorensen pitting. He had worked his way from 13th up to second. Car a little bit tight. They're adjusting for that. To Matt.
Tony Stewart, an easy in to his pit stop. The 33 car on the bottom of your screen now. He says the car needs to be freed up, but no major adjustments. The two car on top of him. They're going to pull some tape off the grill, Steve, because he was running way too hot.
Matt, Kyle Busch has already had his service completed. He'll win the race off of pit road. His car was good everywhere, just a little bit loose in the tri-oval. They made small air pressure adjustments out of the left side tires for Kyle Busch in the 5.
Looks like Martin Truex Jr. in that 8 car, he's going to win the battle off pit road by quite a bit.
I think these boys better be worried if that 08 car gets out front.
I'd say you're right. Tell you what, it was about a mess on pit road. You see tires rolling away. And this will be the race off pit road. Main of the race was for second place. Here you see Martin Truex Jr. in the 8 car. Now finally.
Whoa.
Ooh, that's close. Looked like possibly Johnny Sauter in the 00 beat Menard off.
By 1 inch.
45 down, 72 to go in the Aaron's 312.
Fox welcomes you back to Talladega, Alabama. Nice to have you spending your Saturday afternoon watching some Busch Series racing with us. First 10 laps of the race, four different leaders. Tony Stewart taking the lead from the 17th starting position after Ron White of Blue Collar Comedy gave the command. Threatening weather in the area. Once they got it cranked up, Stewart led the most laps, 25 as of this moment under our first caution. But Talladega means bump drafting.
Yeah, definitely bump drafting. We see right here teammates Brian Vickers and Kyle Busch. Well, he gets a little nudge right there. Mike Wallace, hey, he's not forgotten how to do it either. He's giving his guys a little bit of a push through there. But the most impressive push so far came from Tony Stewart when he gave Carl Edwards a shove right up the middle and took him right into the lead.
Drivers were warned in the drivers' meeting to be careful, cautious, avoiding wrecks. First caution was so far so good. Three-car wreck, Derek Cope in the green car, Regan Smith, and that's Donnie Neuenberger in the white car.
Yeah, a lot of damage right there. Again, you see Regan Smith hard contact with Derek Cope. Derek gets out on his own right there, but all of these cars have a lot of damage, Chris.
And all of the drivers okay. Nine leaders, nine different lead changes, and so far only one caution. That's where we stand at the moment. And Jeff, you happy so far with the way the drivers have kind of controlled their emotions?
I think they've done a pretty good job so far, giving and taking early on. We've seen some really aggressive races so far, so it'll be interesting to see how the rest of the day plays off.
Kyle Busch currently the leader. Let's check in with Dick Berggren for this State Farm Safety Report.
Well, NASCAR has looked very carefully and very hard at automobile accidents and tried to figure out how people can go through them and survive without injury. They've looked at the cars, they looked at the racetracks, of course, and they looked at the driver's compartment. And most important was the driver's compartment. And in that, keeping the driver restrained in an accident is the number one factor. So, all the drivers are wearing heavy-duty seat belts like these in every NASCAR race. When you get into your street car, you ought to be wearing your seat belt as well.
Buckle up for safety. You've been hearing that for years. Now you also hear click it or ticket. And it just makes good sense.
Be in the click. That's a little club they've got going around now that's over home there at some of the high schools.
Well, it's if you start kids out wearing seatbelts, Darrell, they'll never want to ride in a car any other way. So
yeah, my kids, they get in the car. I mean, even in the back seat, they just know to put them on.
Mine too, and Scott, they yell at me to buckle up if
exactly.
I forget going out of the driveway.
You got that right.
Now on this restart, remember you see Denny Hamlin in the 20 car. He's at the tail end of the lead lap. Bernie Lamar in the 77 as well. Those were cars that just had made green flag stops. And how you end up on the tail end of the lead lap is when the leaders pit. You move forward, but you're still a lap down, but now you're at the tail end lead lap as Kyle Busch has given Denny Hamlin in that 20 a push.
Boy, a very strung out restart, almost 7 seconds from the front of the pack to the back.
Well, Denny Hamlin's got a fast race car, so I'm sure Kyle Busch is not thinking this is hurting him any by any means. He's pushing him forward and sucking himself along with him. He'll now look to the inside and make the pass.
I know what's happening in that outside line. Those two black cars, teammate Martin Truex Jr. in the 8 car, Paul Menard in the 11, they're together, they're hooked up, they're on the high side, and they are moving forward.
Steve?
Yeah, Mike, both of those race cars, the 8 and the 11, as you see Martin Truex Jr. go by Kyle Busch, both of them are a little bit tight. You see Paul Menard in the 11. Martin Truex Jr. on his stop, they made an air pressure adjustment and they took some tape off the grill of that number 8, Matt.
Denny Hamlin on the inside lane, second car back, the red 20. Now, he came on the radio moments ago and said the engine is cutting out. They are telling him to swap ignition boxes to see if that will cure his problem.
Sort things out here, but the positions change in the blink of an eye, so it's hard to sort. But Truex and Menard on the point for now, but they are three wide behind them all over the place.
Well, you react when something in front of you happens. You react, and the guy behind you has to be ready to react with you. That's where the thing comes into running into each other.
I think it's time for the folks at home to react with that volume knob on the surround sound and take care of that big investment you got for Christmas. We'll give you some sounds of speed. Why don't you just crank it up?
Don't be bashful. Bottom it out.
lot of three wide in the middle of this pack. Tony Stewart was up to the high side, trying to keep two cars down low alongside. And here we are looking off the back of Kyle Busch.
Same thing happened to Tony again. It happened to him earlier. The five car moved up in front of Tony and took his momentum away.
But just look at that car, where as we're looking over at Kyle Busch, the five car, which the car I was about to talk about, is Jamie McMurray in that 64 car, started back in 35th position. He was in that pack that was well over a half a lap down. Here he is up there in the top 10 now.
Yeah, I think those guys that fell into that second group said, whoops, we better not get that far back again.
That test didn't work.
No, they got lucky.
Kenny Schrader coming back, leading the outside lane through turn two. Sorensen with him, and the 18, that green 18 of our pole sitter J.J.Yeley, getting passed by John Wood at 19th place.
And he 18. Just got back on the lead lap by virtue of the free pass. Our pole sitter got a lap down, made a green flag pit stop right before that caution that came out on lap 42. Now we're riding with Kenny Wallace. He's in the 13th position now in the 22 car. Another car like McMurray decided to go with the strategy. He was in the pack that was just about to get lapped before that caution came out.
I said they were lucky. I guess that'll have to wait and see how that all plays out.
Four wide coming to turn one.
You really, when you're like that, Mike, you really got to crank that wheel hard left when you get down there to turn one, because your car is just not as into the ground as you, into the track as you'd like for it to be. Takes a little extra wheel to get it down in there.
We got two teammates on the inside line, Truex Jr. Menard. We got teammates on the outside, Kyle Busch in the 5, Brian Vickers in the 57, pushing him.
I tell you, Vickers and Kyle Busch have been working really, really well together. They have they stuck together as teammates. Looks pretty
relaxed.
There
you relaxed. Go. Keep digging here. 57 with you. There you go, Don.
Now, by virtue of when that caution came out and all the leaders pitting on lap 45, we know everyone will have to make at least one more pit stop to make it to the end of this thing.
How about old Mike
57
Wallace?
57 is clear. Yep. Do you want
the... Good run.
He's hanging.
John Andretti's fought his way up in the top 10, running side by side with Stewart. Andretti in the 10. And there you're talking about Mike Wallace, who has help from McMurray.
Whoops.
Well, not anymore.
McMurray's going to try to make the same move, but the hole closes.
Yeah, Mike headed just a little bit further up in there than Brian Vickers thought he did, and Vickers was wise and let him go.
And Mike, we asked the question yesterday, why did they put Mike Wallace in this car to replace Jason Keller? I think making moves like that, getting up on that wheel, is what James Finch was looking for out of a driver, regardless of where you finish at the end of the day.
55 laps complete. Kyle Busch leading Brian Vickers by 6/100ths of a second.
The Aaron's 312 on Fox is sponsored by Visa. Go on, live life. Remember that no matter what it takes, life takes Visa. And it takes a lot to win a race like this. Carl Edwards, currently your leader, ahead of Kyle Busch and Tony Stewart. 59 laps in here at Talladega.
Well, right now what I've been watching is just a lot of pushing and shoving going on, a little more bump grabbing, as you want to talk about, especially with the 33 and the 60. I think these guys are finding out real quick that they've got to dance together if they want to work their way to the front. I mean, so far, every time Tony gets behind the 60 car, Carl Edwards, he seems like he moves forward.
Kyle Busch, your leader, said Talladega is a place where you hope for the best, but said that Hendrick Motorsports, he says, has incredible engine and chassis work, the bread and butter.
Oh, did you see that right there? That's what you call a bump draft there.
And a good look up close of somebody working somebody here.
Now that right there is Kyle Busch getting a little help from his teammate right there, Brian Vickers, in the 57 car. He really came up and give him a big shot down the back straightaway. But the key thing is you got to know when to get off of going to these turns. Otherwise, we're going to have the big one.
Larry? Mike, Darryl.
Well, that's it, Darryl. When does help turn into help?
Well, when you get the guy in front of you so messed up that he's got to get off the gas. But here's what happens. You get braver and braver. Don't you see? We started off in this run early in the day. People were being real courteous. They're becoming more and more brave, taking more and more chances.
Like this one a couple laps ago. Tony Stewart into the back end of Carl Edwards, and it got Edwards a little squirrely there.
He's just tickling the back bumper, but it's lifting the rear wheels off the ground.
But, Darrell, it's where you were talking about one of the most treacherous parts of the racetrack coming out of the travel here on the front stretch.
I've seen more things happen right here coming out of the travel to the start-finish line headed down to turn one. I tell you, it gets mighty dicey.
It got dicey, but it did push Edwards to the lead. And watch this bump from Vickers to his teammate, Kyle Busch.
But it's in the middle of the straightaway, and he'll do it all the way down the backstretch. But what I was impressed, by the time they got to turn three, he had backed off by about a half a car length. See, he's starting to get off of him. No problem with that right there in the middle of the backstretch.
I'm pretty amazed at the 57 and the 5 are working together as well as they are. They have been nose to tail ever since this race started.
I know we talked about him just a little bit ago, but I'm being really impressed with this 22 car.
Yeah.
Right behind Brian Vickers, Kenny Wallace started deep in the field, almost went a lap down by virtue of strategy. Here he is battling up at the top five.
Fell to 42nd at the end of the first lap, 32nd on the restart, and up to third by lap 57 for Kenny Wallace.
Now let me see, what year was that he shoved Dale from 18th to the win?
2000.
2000, so we know Kenny can get around this joint.
From the back to the front, it's what, 17 laps?
17 laps.
But what's impressive, we're looking back at his brother, Mike Wallace. What a great race they're having. Wasn't that many hours ago, both these guys missed the Nextel Cup race, so I guarantee you they're enjoying this here, sitting there running third and fourth.
Look right behind this pack, three wide all the way back. Things continue to heat up in Alabama.
The Aaron's 312 on Fox is sponsored by State Farm. Great service, great rates, you can get it all from State Farm. By AOL, what a better high-speed internet. You belong at AOL. By Prilosec OTC, a proud sponsor of NASCAR. And by Subway Restaurants. Subway. Drive hard, eat fresh.
Thirty-three lead lap cars as Paul Tracy just made a stop, went a lap down. Crash. Car upside down. Start finish line.
Tony Stewart.
It is Stewart.
Daniel Quinn in the 50. Got into him.
I don't see anyone else, but Stewart has taken a wild ride. The defending Nextel Cup champion, making an infrequent Busch Series start, was right in the middle of the lead pack.
I don't know what happened here, but what happened over on the back was he gave the 8 car a real shove to get to the lead, and the 8 car dumped him. I mean, he just drove to the inside, left Tony hanging out. I don't know what happened after that.
But we know where it happened.
Right here in the travel.
In the travel.
Yeah, that's a tough part of the track, I'm telling you.
Second caution flag of the day. And points out the downside, or in this case, the flip side, of Nextel Cup drivers running the Saturday race.
Yeah, it's always a big concern.
Man,
I mean, if
there's no oil, have you got pressure?
Danny O'Quinn in the 50 was not part of what started that, but he had nowhere to go as Stewart was sliding down the front stretch here.
Poked him pretty hard in the left side right there. We don't know. It's hard to tell if Tony's all right or not. I'm thinking he probably is, but they won't flip that car over. They won't flip the car over until they get in there and they're able to talk to him.
Car went over, slid a long distance on its right side, as you saw the scuff marks, and then went over on its roof.
So our crew chief Wally Rogers there, anxiously awaiting.
Well, this is so bad to be upside down like this. Even when if you're okay, you're hanging in there.
Yes, we had a situation in the IROC race at Daytona where Steve Kinzer flipped. They were going to just turn the car over, and Kinzer was all right, conscious the whole time. But because Kinzer had undone his belt, they were afraid of risking injury by flipping the car over. So they took their time in extricating him.
And they were trying to get that right side window out, and they couldn't get it out.
You know, I like what they're going to do here, Larry. And I've been wondering why they didn't come up with an apparatus to lift these cars up, so they could get to the driver. It looks to me like that's what they're planning on doing here.
Let's see
watch
if we can
33.
Determine what happened. The 8 car, Tony had just helped the 8 car get to the lead going down the back. The 8 car drove to the inside, and I think Tony thinks there's a hole right there that he's trying to get down in, and there's just not, he just doesn't quite have enough room to get in front of Kenny Wallace. And look at that race car. They just become like feathers blowing in the wind. Now, this is a hard lick right here. Fortunately, it's just it's more in the left front than it is anywhere else.
And it was the right side of Stewart's car that took the brunt of the impact as it went over.
See, he's trying to get down in that hole right there. Not much room. I know Kenny Wallace is doing everything he can, probably to give Tony all the room he can, but there's just not enough room there. You see the roof flaps deploy. Car goes upside down and hits hard on the right, on the left side.
Yeah, the roof flaps deployed. They did their job, but the air just got out from underneath the back of the car. The car came around.
There's Tony. He is okay.
That says so much, though, for the construction of these race cars, whether it's in the Busch Series or the Nextel Cup Series.
Well, you hate to see one of these cars get upside down, especially at these speeds. But Tony Stewart is okay. Pit road is open. Steve?
Mike, no adjustments to that number 8 car for Martin Truex Jr. He did say that he and Tony Stewart were really hauling the mail together. Truex Jr. out right behind Kyle Busch as cars exit pit road.
And pretty much the reason all the leaders hit pit road is we've got 49 laps to go. All of them can make it to the end with that pit stop.
Let's go back and have another look. Looking at Kenny Wallace's car, Darrell, it looked like he was as far down to the inside as is legal, right against the yellow line.
Yeah, here's, well, Kenny Wallace is sitting there saying, oh, please, Tony, don't come down anymore. Don't come down anymore. You hear him get out of the throttle.
He pretty much did everything he could do.
Tony was just trying to get in a hole that really wasn't big enough.
Wow.
Watch out. Now go left. Go left. Caution's out.
How'd you like to be a young driver like Bernie Lamar and have that happen right in front of you?
And that was his teammate, Tony Stewart.
Wrecking behind you. Hand up, hand up, hand up, hand up.
Hand up, signal you're slowing down.
See, it's just right there. Just not quite enough room. And again, as I've said over and over, the car is so light in that part of the racetrack.
From our DLP cable cam. Sixty-eight laps complete. Tony Stewart on his roof, but okay after this wild ride in the Old Spice Chevy. Anxiety, watch this. Tony Stewart, the 33, comes down in front of Kenny Wallace. No fence climbing today for Smoke.
It's amazing how light that car looks when it gets like that.
And Darrell, what I noticed, when that car was in midair, he must have put that foot on that brake pedal because those wheels stopped spinning immediately about the time it lifted off. You see right there, none of the tires are spinning.
Dave Geller, the cameraman who gave us these pictures. Nice shooting, tough ride.
Just enough opening right there in front of Kenny Wallace. I think Smoke thought he could maybe get down there and get back in line.
And the other thing I saw there, Darrell, was look right behind Wallace. Greg Biffle was right there. If Wallace lifts, he gets hit by Biffle. Jeff?
Well, Mike, we've seen right quick how the safety issues came into play when Tony Stewart got upside down. Number one, the roof flaps did deploy to help try to sit the car down. Unfortunately, the angle of the racetrack and the way it did, the car still got upside down. But when it did land, you can see here the roll bars. As we rotate our car, we're going to show you and give you some perspective about what Smoke was feeling. The roll cage then landed on this main cage and slid down the main straightaway. But no one was injured because it did its job. And as you look inside the car, you can get a pretty good idea of what was going on with Smoke. He was inside of this situation right here, and I'm the safety worker trying to get Tony to understand he's okay. Just bear with us. We're going to work on the car and help you get out here in just a second. But a very awkward position for a driver to find himself in. Mike.
Thanks, Jeff. Nice work down there.
Daryl, did you ever end up upside down when the wreck was over in any of your wrecks in any of your cars?
Back in 1971 at Nashville, I flipped over during practice, rolled down into the pits, actually, and was hanging upside down. And I made the mistake of cutting my seatbelt loose, and I like to broke my neck. And
all right, let's listen to the aid of Martin Truex.
Problem, three cars back, they get such a heck of a run that, you know, and it accelerates just like normal. And by the time they get to you, it's kind of like you in that 33. You've got so much speed, you have to go around the guy. You can't hit him.
I know it's tough, but okie dokie. See if we can't get back to the lead again.
That's not the sound of anxiety, is it? Sounds pretty cool, calm, and collected. Well, that's how you win two championships in a row in this series.
Yeah, you know what that driver's thinking? Why are you telling me what to do when I'm the one out here driving the car?
good point.
We're riding with Kenny Wallace now in the 22 car. Came out of the pits in 11th position. Remember, Martin Truex Jr. trying to go for the trifecta. He's won the last two races here.
Kyle Busch will restart up front. In the last seven plate races in the Cup and Busch series, he has not had a finish in the top 25. In fact, he's hardly had a finish. Here he comes with the lead, with Martin Truex in tow and his teammate Brian Vickers third.
And we need to mention Denny Hamlin in the 20 car still fighting ignition box problems. He did get the free pass back on the lead lap. That leaves Bernie Lamar there in that 77 yellow car, Tony Stewart's teammate, trying to get back on the lead lap. He's the first car lap down after making that green flag pit stop earlier.
Yeah, and actually, Aston Lewis in here are the only two guys that are eligible right now. They're one lap down. So if he can just maintain for a while here and get another caution.
Log jam lead change.
I tell you, they'll wait car. Now, the one thing the eight car's missing this year that he's had in the past is his little buddy pushing him. And so that could be a big difference. He doesn't really have a teammate up there, even though 11's trying.
All right, two drivers involved in that crash, Stewart, Danny O'Quinn. Here's Dick.
Danny O'Quinn has just emerged from the care center. You okay?
Yeah, I'm fine. The car probably isn't so good, but, you know, it's just Talladega for you there. We had a really good race car. I mean, you never know what's going to happen. I talked to Tony there in the infield care center, and, I guess him and somebody else got together, and he was upside down. I didn't have anywhere to go, so that's just one of those deals. But, I'm fine. Our Stonebridge Life Insurance Ford Fusion was really good today. I thought we were going to come out of a good run, but, we'll work on it. Maybe we can get it back out there and make a few laps.
Best thing we just heard, conversation with Tony Stewart. Mike?
Yeah, but Tony is okay. And hopefully he'll be released shortly and we'll get a word with him. Three wide again. They stack him up in turn three. This is a big stack here. Yep. Four wide.
Bottleneck. Look at this.
And it cost Kyle Busch the lead. He went back to mid-pack from first place.
He finally found him a hole to get into. And, of course, back to Martin Truex Jr., your little buddy you were talking about is his car owner, Dale Earnhardt Jr.
Dale Earnhardt Jr. has been out here in the last couple of years helping him to the front, keeping him in the front. Boy, that stage dry is driving me crazy. All that dust flies up.
McMurray with a run on the top side, trying to catch up to the 11 of Menard in the outside lane.
You know, Larry, it never fails. I mean, my heart rate has picked up a notch. I'm thinking that their heart rate has picked up a notch, and the intensity has doubled.
Well, and they pretty much know that they may have what they've got here, because we may not see another pit stop to the end of this thing's over.
This race is going by fast.
Tell you what, give a call to Scott Riggs there in that 9 car driving for Ray Evernham. He's worked his way up to the front right there behind Brian Vickers in the 57 car.
Yeah, I've been watching the 9. He's been very, very cautious. Hadn't been doing anything. He's just kind of been maintaining, minding his manners. See, just like right there, he moved down and made room.
Yep, gave the outside up, and they're 3 wide again into turn 1. 3 wide, 4 rows deep. Wow.
About as deep as you could look.
But right now, you're on fresh tires. Car's driving pretty good. And like I said, it's time to quit playing and get serious.
Yeah, last time by, 25 cars within 2 seconds of each other when they came by the start-finish line.
For maybe another 10 or so laps, it must be going to get serious.
You know, see Reed Sorensen up there in the 41 car. The Dodges didn't qualify very well, but we're seeing a lot of Dodges up there in the top 10 now as this race now has 41 laps to go.
Ooh, that's
4 wide in the tri-oval.
That's treacherous going right there, I got to tell you.
Reed Sorensen, somehow that car slipped a little bit and everybody jumped either side to take advantage.
And when it slips a little bit, I mean, a driver instinctively wants to let off a little bit. And when he does, I mean, you're surrounded by so many cars, you either get passed or run over. Trust me, when you're in this mess right here, you are not. Every muscle in your body is tense.
You know, is there one of those Blue Ox tow bars between Vickers and Busch? Because they're just welded together.
But now they're welded together a different way than they were most of the first part of the race, because most of the race it was Kyle Busch in the 5 being pushed by Brian Vickers in the 57.
They have been really committed to each other. You saw Kyle, or you saw Brian go down there, fake in front of the 8, comes back up, gets Kyle right behind him again, and here they go.
And behind them, Scott Riggs with a little bump draft, and Mike Wallace. That's the middle lane. Tony Stewart released from the care center. Dick is with him.
Well, you have flipped worse than that before. How bad was that one, though?
Yeah, that was pretty easy. I even had plenty of time to talk to him while we were sliding upside down, so it wasn't bad at all. It just tore the car up really bad, but it was my fault. I'll take 100% responsibility for that one. I just tried to get back in line there, and I think I clipped the 22 car on the right front when I came down, so it wasn't anybody's fault but mine. I was the one that caused that one.
What was it like inside the car when you lifted and you knew you were going over?
Well, I said, this ought to be pretty spectacular, but I was telling John Darby, I said, man, there's a lot of stuff on the racetrack when you get upside down and that door starts scooping it up in there. So we were just laughing about it. I mean, it really wasn't that bad of a ride. You worry about it digging in. Once it stayed on its roof and settled in, I thought we were going to be all right, but I was just worried about it digging and then starting barrel rolling or something crazy like that. But once it got on its top and it just settled in like that, it wasn't too bad a ride.
Everybody's glad you're okay. Thanks, Mo.
Boy, that's something. You can get upside down at 180 miles an hour and laugh about it 15 minutes later. 78 laps complete, 39 to go, and the vise begins to tighten as they keep running 3 wide near the front.
Gotta.
Things continue to be dicey right here. This is the eye of the storm. Now there's a 5-car breakaway in front of a 3-wide battle. Right there, Jamie McMurray smack in the middle of it. The lap car, Bernie Lamar inside, and Reed Sorensen gives a shove to try to move forward. That works for a little while.
Boy, did he ever give Jamie McMurray that 64 car shove. Look how far out front he pulled a Reed Sorensen.
You know the difference in the guys that haven't raced here much and the guys that have? The guys that haven't raced here much say, I wonder what that would do.
Yeah.
Other guys say, I know what that'll do.
Well, let's do the math. There are your lap leaders today. Kyle Busch and Tony Stewart have led 25 laps each. Martin Truex out front right now.
Update our points leader. He's not made a lot of noise here. Kevin Harvick in the 21 car. Remember, he is the owner of that 33 car of Tony Stewart. Right now, Kevin's sitting back there in 24th position with 34 laps to go.
Which is surprising, Larry, because ran up front again at the beginning of this race, but he hasn't been heard of much lately.
Now he's been up into the top 10, Dick, but really we've not seen Harvick near the front.
No, and that's a bit of a surprise, Mike. I think most everybody had expected that, but he didn't qualify all that well. He qualified in the 19th position, but a few laps ago, I talked with his crew chief, Shane Wilson, asked him what was going on, and he said that they were just riding back there. Wilson said they didn't think they had the car to win, but they do have a car that can pick up some more spots before the race ends.
Well, Dick, remember what I said at the beginning of the show. You can go from the front to the back to the front to the back. And he might just be laying back there for that last 10-lap charge.
Kind of looks like to me he's racing like a man that has almost a 300-points lead. What
and
do you
wants
think?
To add to it.
There you go.
But he doesn't want to lose any. Let's put it that way.
He's also getting some useful practice for tomorrow, where he will start outside the top 40 in the Aaron's 499.
Boy, big surprise how he and Jeff Burton both qualified late in the session today.
There are the point standings. As things sit right now, Yeley started today on pole. Denny Hamlin had a soft tire, hasn't fared that well. Carl Edwards has led this race, and Clint Bowyer led a lap.
We mentioned earlier in the show of those top five, none of them have ever had a top 10 finish here, and right now the only one in the top 10 is Carl Edwards in the 60 car in fourth.
For the lead, Vickers looking low. Kyle Busch can't get with him because Vickers has help from Carl Edwards.
Probably about the four best cars right there that you see in your screen there at the front of the picture, the 8, the 60, the 5, and the 57.
Let's check with Steve.
Mike, some kind of a power issue for Jamie McMurray in the 64. He had worked his way up into the lead draft. He said the water's good, oil's good, temperature's good, but right now it just won't run. He's checked all the gauges.
Yeah, he's about 3 seconds off the pace right now, Jamie McMurray in the 64 car, all the way back out of the top 30. And right now, Martin Truex Jr. in the 8, he's getting help from Bernie Lamar in the 77 car. Bernie is actually a lap down in that Dollar General car. If we get a caution, he obviously would get the free pass. 31 laps to go.
Yeah, for a car that ran, obviously it's a fast car, runs second at Daytona, gets a lucky break here, maybe get back in this thing.
Scott Riggs going by. Johnny Sauter in the 00 was alongside the 11 of Paul Menard a lap ago for 10th place. Now things heat up right. There goes Sauter in that bright orange Chevrolet. And now he's got J.J. Yeley tucked along as they're four wide again. McFarland split the middle in the Navy car. Just sent a big wake as he drove up through the center of the pack.
Yeah, the yellow car, Bernie Lamar there, he's just trying to get out of the way. He got up there near the front, but now he's a lap down. He's the first car that's eligible to get the pass. Something should happen.
Sauter with his brother Jay alongside back there. Vickers trying to hold on to the lead with help from an unlikely source, the Ford of Carl Edwards.
Right now, you'll help anybody that can help you.
That's your best friend.
Yeah. That'll change here shortly.
30 laps to go. Brian Vickers, former series champion, out in front of the Aaron's 312.
The Aaron's 312 on Fox is sponsored by Allstate, official insurance sponsor of NASCAR. Carl Edwards, a little bit of an adventure moments ago. Martin Truex Jr., by the way, who had the lead and has slipped back just a bit as we look at Carl Edwards.
Yeah, right now, Stephen got himself a little bit of trouble coming off of turn four through the travel area right there. Got loose and I think saved his car. Now he's now limping around the speedway trying to get back to the pit area. Take a look right there as he comes off the turn. Down low, you see the car. All of a sudden, he gets a little bit dancy and he gets, I believe, a little bit of help. Yes, he does. Right there in the back from the 43 car. He's down on the apron and he does a pretty good job of hanging on to that ride right there,
yeah,
Chris.
No caution coming up.
No caution because of it, but he definitely right there got his attention.
And Stephen White, 19-year-old from Asheville, North Carolina, part of Robert Yates of the developmental driving where they share the ride here.
He's definitely a developmental driver. First race here today, shares the ride with Elliott Sadler as well as Dale Jarrett for the Robert Yates Racing.
I want to go back to Martin Truex, who currently is the leader. No driver has ever won his first three races at a particular track. If Truex were to win today, he would be 3-for-3 here at Talladega.
That's what you call batting 1,000.
Let's rejoin Darrell, Larry, and Mike.
Kyle Busch's temperature's got to be on boil because a lap ago right here, coming into the tri-oval, he got sent almost up to the wall, and it knocked him out of the top four. Now Kenny Schrader's alongside him on the outside, and Busch is backing up. Let's show you what happened, because this was almost really big.
Right here coming into the tri-oval. That's Martin Truex Jr. in the 8 car. Gave him a shove right there. He was up in no man's land, but he never touched the wall. Look at the run he got up there off the high side.
Lucky he didn't cut a tire down, because a lot of dirt and debris up there. That's the biggest thing.
He was trying to stay off his teammate, Brian Vickers, and almost got the wall.
The thing about that young man, as we all know, it doesn't take a whole lot to set him off. So that was not, it's not a good time to get knocked around like that.
Darrell, it just looks like it's going to be tough to beat the group that's going on the bottom. We talked about it at the top of the show. If you stay lined up on the bottom, you really got to have a pretty good game to go around you on the top side.
Let them look. Just give me the bottom.
Hug that yellow line.
You don't get squeezed into the wall when you're on the bottom. You only get squeezed into the wall when you're on the outside.
Wasn't that long ago we were mentioning our points leader, Kevin Harvick, in that 21 car. He was back to the 24th position. He has now worked his way up into the top 10. That's the Coast Guard car there.
And the other thing, Larry, is when you're down there, you see that big old yellow line? That's just like having a wall.
Exactly, because it's out of bounds if you go below it.
You only got to protect one side.
How about our All-State good hands driver of the race? Might be a little early, but I think Kyle Busch, for staying off his teammate Brian Vickers. Watch Vickers come way up the racetrack. And Busch staying off Vickers and off the wall. That takes good hands. Allstate, official insurance partner of NASCAR.
I'll give it a 9.9 and a 10 for style.
You can call it hands if you want to. I say he got good feet because he never lifted.
Just 22 laps to go. And there are still 12 cars within a second of the lead.
The Aaron's 312 on Fox is sponsored by Aaron Sales and Lease Ownership. Nobody beats Aaron. Nobody. By Red Lobster, the wait is over. Lobsterfest is back right now at Red Lobster. By AOL, if you want a better high-speed internet, you belong at AOL. And by Scotch Turf Builder with +2, it kills dandelions and gives you a thick green lawn. 19 laps to go at Talladega. Chris Myers, Jeff Hammond watching from the Hollywood Hotel. Brian Vickers leads Kyle Busch and Reed Sorensen. But what about the points champ here in the Busch Series so far? I should say points leader, Kevin Harvick, as we have a caution coming out.
You got a caution coming out. 64 car right there, Jamie McMurray, on pit road. And if he got on pit road, he may be okay. He may get a freebie here, as you may say.
All right, debris on the track. Let's rejoin Darrell, Larry, and Mike.
It may have been from Ashton Lewis. They were looking at him for a hood pin problem as there's McMurray coming down pit road. This is going to be a tough one to score because there was at least one pack that was four wide when the caution waved.
There's all the debris back there, Mike, quite a bit of it. And see it out there by the wall.
But remember, unless it's the end of the race, the way they score it is when the caution comes out, you have the loops all the way around the racetrack. They'll go back to the previous loop that all the cars crossed. That's how they'll restart them here. But here's the interesting thing, guys. Everyone was on pit road 32 laps ago. We're going to have about 15 laps to go in this race, and we've got 30, 31 cars on the lead lap. I believe most of the guys at the front will stay out, keep that track position.
Yeah, Larry, this is what I'm going to say. I can't hear you.
Well, I'm in.
A couple things happened in that last green run. First of all, Brian Vickers and Kyle Busch did get back together, get back to the front, displacing Martin Truex. And also, Kevin Harvick has come back up into the top half dozen, or come up into the top half dozen for what could have been the first time today, our point leader. So, 18 laps to go, and still anything can happen.
Oh, no.
Caution for debris, and pit road is open. Among the takers is our point leader, Dick.
Kevin Harvick has pitted because he told the crew that he simply could not see out of the windshield. Something clouded that windshield up, perhaps following a car that loaded it up with oil. He took four tires in the car and adjustments in both the right and left rear. He also didn't have enough gas if this thing went green-white checker.
So Harvick had moved up to sixth, and now he'll go back to 30th on the restart.
There's a good example of what Harvick was trying to do. That's from the 60 car, and I guess Harvick's was even worse than that. So I got to tell you, to be bunched up in this restart, side by side as close as you're going to be, you need to be able to see pretty well.
Here's why we're under caution. Watch the car of Ashton Lewis Jr. down the back straightaway. Some metal pieces come loose and deposit themselves on the straightaway. Caution flag.
We had about a dozen cars of our lead lap cars, 30 cars on the lead lap that pitted. Now Bernie Lamar, the 77, finally gets back on the lead lap with the free pass.
So 31 cars on the lead lap and probably, 20 or so that have a chance to win this 16 laps from now. They're going to restart here with 14 laps to go. And the win very much in doubt. Martin Truex on point, but without any help from teammates. Right behind him, the two Hendrick cars of Vickers and Busch. Then Boyer for Childress Racing. Edwards for Jack Roush. Sorensen for Chip Ganassi. The Roush Ford of Biffle. And then Mike Wallace, Scott Riggs, and Jay Sauter, the top 10.
This is a small town. When we all come to town, NASCAR crowd comes to town, they create a small town.
Now to update you on our points leader, Kevin Harvick, the 21 car, pitted that time with 11 other cars. He'll restart in the 18th position with 14 laps to go.
Might want to keep an eye on him. He's going to be coming in a hurry. We've already seen him come from back there and get up to six in a pretty short period of time.
Ryan Vickers in the 57 car, his teammate Kyle Busch in the 5, the 103 laps of this race. I think they've been hooked up in one configuration or the other for about 100 of those 103 laps.
Yeah, actually, Brian looks like he might be a little quicker than Kyle. They run better with the 57 in front, although I know the 5 is anxious to get back into the lead.
Carl Edwards in the 60, snuck a peek to the outside, fell back in line in front of Reed Sorensen in the 41 car.
Biffle 7th trying to get up there and work with Edwards, his teammate.
Pretty good breakaway right there, that front group.
How about our leader, Steve?
Mike, right before the restart, Martin Truex Jr. spotter Joey Meyer said, use that yellow line. That yellow line is your friend. And he said also, use the force of that pace game. Martin Truex Jr. said, copy that. It's been working well so far. Nick Bergeron.
I've been listening to Brian Vickers on the radio all day, Steve, and he has been so calm and so cool except for just a couple of moments ago. While under caution, he came under the start-finish line and saw the lights that posted car number 25. He keyed the radio and said, "What have I done wrong?" They reminded him today he's in car 57. Car 25 is his cup car.
Very good.
That's funny right there. I don't care who you are.
He's getting a push from Kyle Busch right now. Now there's a breakaway of about 8 cars here and a ways back to the pack that Kevin Harvick is dealing with. Harvick restarted 18th.
And Carl Edwards in the 60, who was running 5th, jumped to the high side. No one went with him. He'll fall to the back of that lead lap pack. But as that group starts to line up back there, they're starting to catch our lead pack. 12 to go.
Very dicey back here, where Johnny Sauter and Scott Riggs lead the second pack. That's where all the 2 and 3 wide racing is. You see the leaders have gotten single file to try to break away.
Well, they can sit out there for a little while, but they're not gone by any means.
Brian Vickers in the 57 jumped to the high side. Kyle Busch, the 5, is his teammate, would not go with him. He's going to leave him out there by himself.
He's afraid to open up the bottom for the 2 car.
He looks like he wanted to go, but he knew better because he saw what happened to Carl Edwards.
Maybe through the triangle here, he can jump out there and help out. Let's see what he does. No, he's going to ride the bottom on the yellow line. He's going to say to his teammate, adios.
And Vickers in the 57 has no help out there on the outside.
He better duck in that hole right there behind the 41. Closing fast.
Deals, no deals. It gets interesting now.
Deals are off.
Kevin Harvick has caught the lead pack. He's made it back into the top 10. Brian Vickers, once abandoned by his teammate Kyle Busch, slid back almost out of the top 10. Comers and goers.
But you know what? That's good news for the 8 car, because with the 5 and the 57 working together, I believe they could have overtaken the 8. But now it's just the 5 and the 8.
Yeah, that seven-car breakaway, though, it's now about two dozen cars up there in the lead pack.
Oh, yeah, you can't get away.
There's Harvick.
You can run, but you cannot hide.
Right behind Johnny Sauter's double O. And Vickers trying to come back up through, as is the green car. Pole sitter J.J. Yeley working the way high side, taking the long way around. Not a lot of help up there right now.
Imagine a sprint car driver former riding the high side on the cushion.
But the bottom is the short way around, and that's where Truex is leading a five-car draft, right locked onto him on the bottom.
Well, I preach to my guys all the time. We run Daytona, and you know, the yellow line is your best friend.
8 laps to go.
And I'm sure Kyle Busch in the five, he may want to wait a few laps. He'd love to go to the high side, but the question is mine, will the two go with me, or will he do what I did to my teammate, Brian Vickers, and stay on the bottom?
Well, that's somewhat, the two is almost a teammate to the eight. I mean, that's a better marriage or a better connection than the five is.
There comes Vickers, though, in a 57, fighting back with work from Kevin Harvick in the 21.
Harvick, Steve.
Well, Mike, to answer what Larry McReynolds just said or add to it, Kyle Busch's crew chief, Chad Walter, told him seconds ago, if you're going to make a move, you better make sure you have help because everybody has their own agenda now.
I guarantee you, deal's off, Steve. Seven to go.
Three wide, mid-pack. Briggs behind Leffler in the middle, and they stack up here closer to the front. With Menard on the outside in the 11.
Hey, Mike Wallace is getting pushed to the front whether he wants to go or not.
Right.
I'm going to tell you what, Vickers gave him a shot here at the start-finish line. Now Mike Wallace up there bump drafting on Brian, on Clint Bowyer, the two.
No, they're hooked up like a train now.
Yep, coupled together.
There's no bump to it. It's just like a train. And here comes that two car on the outside.
And here comes Harvick. He is right there in the lead mix in sixth place.
Watch Martin, though. Got to stay there. Hang on to that yellow line, buddy, because you got
it. Oh, J.J. Yeley got slammed into the wall.
Caution is out.
Dadgum.
Boy, I hate that.
Now, remember, the way they will score the cars is where they were when they crossed the last scoring loop before the caution came out.
Right. Doesn't have anything to do with the start-finish line necessarily.
Field is frozen.
Fourth caution of the day.
Remember,
and
when
you see that little bit of damage on the left rear corner of J.J. Yeley's car, and that's likely what caused him to get up and into the outside wall.
Ride the bottom. You don't get forced into the wall. I mean, you don't get knocked into the wall when you're on the bottom.
J.J.'s okay. Moving around in the car, window net down.
They're going to have to bring in on a rollback.
That's a signal that he's all right. And look right there, right on the corner of that rear bumper cover, just that little bit of bump. That's all it takes here at 180 plus to get a car around and hard in the wall. Let's see where it came from.
Well, he was up on that's the 99 there behind him. Let's see if they make contact. I'm thinking they probably do.
There's the contact right there, just on the exit of turn four. Pretty hard into the outside wall. Now, J.J. came in here fourth in the points. He had an opportunity to possibly leave here third in the points today. Pretty hard lick.
Yep. Riding with Bernie Lamar. There's Yeley on the right of your screen.
Three wide, but doing good. Three wide.
Boy, just
been here.
Ever so slightly contact, but. Just not, Michael just need to give him a little bit more room. But you know, you can't let off. You can't use the brakes.
It's not that often when you have someone in the middle of the pack hit the outside wall and come back across the racetrack here, it ends up being a single car accident.
There's JJ, started on pole, ends up in the garage. Chris Myers.
Mike, let's recap quickly now with just 5 laps to go under caution. The first 10 laps of this race had four different leaders. Tony Stewart taking the lead from the 17th spot. This was the first caution. Derek Cope in the green, the 49 car. Regan Smith in the 35, the red car. And Donnie Neuenberger in the white vehicle involved. All of this at over 180 miles per hour. All the drivers were okay. That was just a sampling of what was to come. In the meantime, a lot of
bump drafting for position.
Yes, that's what you always want to see here at Talladega. See the 33 car of Tony Stewart giving Carl Edwards in the 60 a little bit of a love push, basically down the trial. And again, here's some teammates. Brian Vickers gives Kyle Busch a good shot down the back straightaway, pushes him out in front.
Tony Stewart had led 25 laps, jockeying for position here. A nudge for Kenny Wallace, going 185, 190. That's what, 3,400 pounds through the air. Tony upside down, bumped by rookie Danny O'Quinn. Stewart said, hey, it was a wild ride. I was okay, and took responsibility, said it was all his fault.
Definitely his fault right there. You see Tony getting out of the car, waving at the crowd. Again, NASCAR safety rules and regulations kind of coming through one more time.
28 different lead changes in this race, and Dale Earnhardt would have been 55 years old today. Martin Truex Jr. leading in a car owned by Teresa Earnhardt. Tomorrow you'll want to be with us on Fox, 12:30 local time, 1:30 Eastern. Dale Jarrett, the most recent Talladega winner. He'll burn 10 laps with me. The Drive and Ride. DW and Jeff give you a feel of what it's like to go around the longest track on NASCAR. And DW's on a rampage. We'll tell you about what. He's angry about something and confused. Jeff Gordon has seen victory lane here, but not this year. So we'll hear more from the driver of the 24. Talladega Nightstar, Will Ferrell, will check in. That'll be worth a laugh. All that gas and go with our guys. Tomorrow on Fox, 1:30 Eastern, 10:30 Pacific at 12:30 Talladega time. And here's a look at the front row for tomorrow. Yep. Elliott Sadler, Tony Stewart, who has never won here at Daytona. Of course, never finished a Busch race here at Talladega, I should say, out of the race today. We'll look for that tomorrow. Mike?
Chris, we're going to have a three-lap shootout here in Alabama as Martin Truex leads Clint Bowyer, Brian Vickers, Kyle Busch, and Kevin Harvick up into the top five after restarting 18th after the last caution. We've had 28 lead changes. The record is 30. No reason that record can't be broken. Matt.
And Clint Bowyer was on the radio moments ago, Mike. Now, he was debating. He thought he actually was in front of Truex when the caution came out. They told him that looking back, NASCAR has shown on the loop system that he was indeed in second place. And then his team said, look, that's actually better because we were looking at a possible green-white checkered or close to it. You want to be in second to make your run, not have them make a run on you. And then Richard Childress, back from Africa, who many said they thought he should stay there the way his team's been running, the good luck rolling in the right direction. But Childress said, look, keep your eyes on your mirror. At this point in time, it's more on you because things are going to happen so fast that your spotter can't tell you to give you a heads up.
Darrell, how do you beat Martin Truex in this three-lap shootout?
Well, you got to. The 57 car is now back in third place. His teammate five there, Kyle Busch, we know they want to make a move. It's up to the two car to go with them. I think those three guys are going to try to hook up and maybe go around Martin up there if they can work a deal.
Larry, we pretty well know that Truex is going to hold the bottom. Can they get him?
Yeah, I mean, but it's going to take two or three cars. But the thing about it, when I look at those top five cars, when you look at Martin Truex Jr., Brian Vickers, you know what? It's all about winning the race. They don't care about finishing second, third. They're not points racing. No. It's about winning.
Well, I just believe that if you take Vickers, Busch, and even Harvick, they're going to go to the outside here and try to make a pass.
J.J. Yeley checked at the infield care center and released. He is okay.
I got to believe Brian Vickers has got a car that's more than capable of winning this race because look how far back he fell and look where he is. And, of course, there's Harvick who pitted and look where he is.
Yeah, don't discount Harvick coming from fifth. He may have the best seat of all for this three-lap shootout. Here we go.
Goes Vickers in the 57 to the inside of Clint Bowyer. Kyle Busch, his teammate, will follow him. Now they kick Bowyer to the outside.
Boy, Bowyer just opened the door going into one, and man, is he going to pay the price.
He's going to go from second probably to about 12th or 14th.
And now this is like a party for the 57 and the 5. All they got to do is work together.
Yeah, and not take each other out.
They were all shoving each other down the backstretch.
Brian Vickers will use that bumper. Just ask Mike Bliss last year in Charlotte in May.
Coming to two to go.
Oh, man, did you see Kyle Busch? He tried to
Everybody
cut down under his teammate and lost the back end.
Once again, Truex in that 8 car, hugging that yellow line. 2 to go this time.
Oh, boy. Oh, boy.
Harvick giving Busch a shove.
Did you see the 5? It knocked the 57 sideways. You know what the 5 telling the 57? Go on. Don't set it. Go on.
Just have at it.
Yeah.
I hear you knocking, but you can't come in.
57 ain't running for points. Go for the win, baby.
Hoyer and Sauter got together, traded a little paint.
Come on, man.
The push from the 5.
Get the push.
The 57 halfback. Still single file behind you. The high
comes
lane.
Hoyer in the 2 car. Fighting back on the high side.
Well, that's what's going to really make a mess here is when somebody gets up there on the outside. Then you got to do something.
And that time is coming.
White flag, buddy.
1 to go.
Now, we got a slow car up here, the 34, that they're going to catch up to.
There goes, hey, there goes the 5
and
to the outside.
Harvick went upstairs to pick up Boyer, but Kyle Busch went up in front of them.
And Truex, he's trying to stay halfway in front of that group, too.
21
Truex. Needs to get back to the bottom.
He's a setting duck, Larry. He's a setting duck.
They'll get a run on him. Here comes Busch. Here comes Harvick.
There they go.
Push it. 21's outside the 5. The 21's outside. He's by himself. You're 2 ahead of that group in your mirror. 21 and 2 on the high lane. They are 2 ahead.
Harvick has got to have help to have a shot. Otherwise, the black car goes to victory lane.
Here he comes. If he can get to the inside right there.
Truex blocks.
He's got it made. Eight's going to win the race. There's no way. The eight's going to get a little suck off his lap car up here. The eight's going to win the race.
Martin Truex.
Three arrows.
The Aaron 312.
You better keep the cameras rolling. They're not done yet until they get through turn 1 and 2.
My goodness.
No driver had ever won his first 3 Busch Series starts at one track. Darrell at Daytona won his first 2, was 3rd in the 3rd race.
Do something cool for your victory.
Matt, what are you talking about? That was cool.
Mark, that was very enjoyable, guys.
Look at the side of that car. Look at the wheel marks down the left side.
I was looking at a bunch of them when it went by last time, Larry. They're all beat up like they've been to Martinsville.
Real quick, we'll give a real big call to Mark McFarland. Driving for Junior Motorsports, finishes in 7th in that 88 car.
I think the drive of the day, Kevin Harvick from 18th, a restart ago, to finish 2nd.
Pretty good show right there.
That's a way to pad your point lead.
He's up to 299 unofficially now. It's Mark Trips Jr.'s girlfriend.
Okay. How much of it was the paint? You got that Dale Earnhardt commemorative paint scheme on there. It's Dale Earnhardt Day in Mooresville, where everybody visiting DEI today, as many as 20,000 strong, they've got to have the big screen on, and they've got to be enjoying this.
And I know everybody visiting this racetrack today, they have not left. They want to see this celebration.
He's got a bass on the hood, but he got some horses underneath it.
Holding 3 fingers aloft, Martin Truex Jr. comes around and salutes the crowd at Talladega.
That's the way I like it. Good stuff, good stuff.
3 fingers in the air, boys. That's cool as hell.
Yes, it is.
Remember David Vidal's birthday.
From our DLP cable cam. A little smoke show, and he wants the flag.
Yeah.
That was cool. The man would have been proud there, Mark.
Yes, he would have.
Going to have to reach up something to get it, I think.
Oh, they can't get it stuck in the fence.
Yeah, it's a double fence there. And
I don't think it's going to fit. Oh, man. There he goes.
We'll make it work. One of the Speedway security staff helping out there.
Now it'll fall on the ground.
He'll figure out how to get it.
Jump out there and get it, Martin.
Two two-time NASCAR Busch Series champion Martin Truex Jr. Here is the Red Lobster catch of the day. Always a good catch, just like this one. The pass that got him the lead past the Hendrick tag team of Vickers and Kyle Busch.
Yeah, he was fighting the Hendrick tag team of Busch and Brian Vickers, also the tag team of Kevin Harvick and Clint Bowyer.
Back down to protect the low side, hug that yellow line, and win the Aaron's 312.
Not too bad for his teammate, Menard, back there in ninth, no. In the other black car.
Martin Truex, your winner, heads for victory lane.
Martin Truex Jr. mixing it up in victory lane. Your winner today, led seven times, took the lead for the last time on lap 136. Holding off Kevin Harvick. You can look at the final results. Dick Bergman is down there with him. Dick?
It is so wet down here. Now, hey, for those last several laps, you were a sitting duck, and everybody behind you had a big gun. How intense were those last few laps?
Well, I had teammates all around me, but, man, this thing, it was good.
Well, you had some Hendrick cars around you, too.
Yeah, a couple Hendrick cars, a couple Childress cars, a couple Roush cars, and little old me out there by myself, but... Big E was riding in her today. This old black and silver car got it done.
Who did the donuts on the door for you?
Oh, that was Paul Menard. He's my teammate, and he just wanted to give us a congratulations on the racetrack. So this is really awesome for the whole company. Everybody's working really hard, and it's a great tribute for Dale Earnhardt on his birthday. And three in a row, man, this is great.
Well, congratulations. Steve's with one of the Hendrick drivers. Steve?
And that's Kyle Busch, Dick Bergeron. And, boy, Kyle, you had a great race car. You're near the front all day. Take us to the closing laps.
Well, it's tough on a green-white checker restart to try to do anything, really. You know, it's very difficult in that respect. But all in all, man, I really want to thank my guys for giving me a great Lowe's Monte Carlo SS today. It was awesome. And as well as that O'Ride Extra Crispy car, too. It was awfully fast. And whenever we could get, you know, tucked up together, man, we were very strong. And it was cool there for the majority of the race, but, you know, that 8 car was just way too good today. Congratulations to those guys. One-off deal and he wins. I mean, what the heck? Restrictor plate race, I guess. But, you know, all in all, we had a great day today. I'm grateful for even coming out of here with a race car. You know, that's the first point that we tried to make today. And, you know, we can go on to next week. And great points today overall.
Thank you, Kyle. Let's go to Matt Yoakum.
Owner Richard Childress walked up, and the first thing he said to Kevin Harvick, I should have stayed in Africa, and you would have won the race. But you were setting up your plan to the front, and then the five of Busch took the hard right-hand turn. That put the kibosh on your run.
Yeah, we just had to swing so far to the right there and scrub a little bit of speed. And, you know, he did what he had to do. But our U.S. Coast Guard Chevrolet was good all day and came in there at the end because I couldn't see out of the windshield. So we had to put four tires on and fill it up with gas for a green-white checkered. But all in all, good day.
Scores his first top five finish in a Busch Series car here at Talladega, Mike.
Thanks, Matt. Let's have a look at the standings as Harvick padded his point lead with that second place finish today. He's now 299 up on Clint Bowyer.
See Bernie Lamar, the rookie, still hanging in there in the top 10. The most impressive thing today, I know we had somewhat of an ugly wreck with Tony Stewart in the 33 car, but only four cautions, a couple of those just debris cautions.
Well, there's guys just outside of the top five or six there, Larry, that really had great finishes. Jay Sauter, a great finish in the double zero. Scott Riggs, 11th. Mike Wallace, Kenny Wallace, Michael, Jay Sauter, Johnny Andretti, Ray Torrenson, Jason Leffler, a bunch of guys. Johnny Wood, they all had great finishes today.
In fact, 20 cars finished this race within 1 second of Martin Truex.
And 29 cars on the lead lap. It's been a long time since we saw that here.
You could throw a blanket over about 20 of them.
And more to come tomorrow, Chris.
28 lead changes, the most we've seen in a race this year, so a lot of excitement, a lot of drama. Martin Truex Jr. referring to Dale Earnhardt Sr., who would have been 55 on this day, and Chance 2 Motorsports, co-owned by Teresa Earnhardt and Dale Earnhardt Jr., who we'll see tomorrow. Also, Martin Truex Jr. will start 20th tomorrow, but first a thought on today's race. A lot of drama, a lot of excitement.
A lot of excitement. The thing is right now, the key issue here today will be the same for tomorrow. You've got to have help. You've got to find that dance partner or that individual who can help you get to the front. Kevin Harvick said it. I had to help to get back up there. A lot of these guys pushing, shoving, beating, and banging. But if, in the end, if you've got a friendly face behind behind you, you got a chance.
All right, and some wonder about DEI's hold on restrictor plate racing. Of course, Jeff Gordon has had a lot of success in that department most recently. Fox and FX and Speed's coverage continuing tomorrow. NASCAR Race Day on Speed leading up to our Cup Series racing on Fox. And the Aaron's 499, that's at 1:30 Eastern. We'll talk to Jeff Gordon, go 10 laps with Dale Jarrett. And DW is confused about some of NASCAR's rulings and on-track judgments. He'll clear that up for all of us in the pre-race show. Promotional consideration provided by these five folks. Martin Truex Jr. led 36 laps. Tony Stewart led 25 laps. Kyle Busch also led 25.
Gentlemen, start your engines!
Blue Collar Comedy. That's Ron White giving the command. Tomorrow it'll be Will Ferrell as the Grand Marshal here when we'll go just a little bit further. Tony Stewart going airborne, flipped over in this race, but walked away okay. Took responsibility, said it was something he could laugh about. We'll see what he's smiling about tomorrow. NASCAR's draft day. Tomorrow, thanks for being a part of NASCAR on Fox.